Welcome to this video lecture series on chemical tanker notes for nautical science students. Let's start off with the notes. First, we'll see what are the types of tank coatings that are available on chemical tankers and why is the need for tank coating. So, a modern chemical tanker shall have all the cargo tanks coated unless they are made of stainless steel. Stainless steel, as we know, that it's very inert product and will not react with most of the other chemicals. So the main reasons for coating are easier cleaning and less risk of cargo contamination. The durability of properly applied and maintained coatings may be 10 years or more. On the other hand, one mistake in the cargo selection may totally ruin a coating. So if you load a cargo which is not suitable to that coating, then the coating will get spoiled instantaneously because of the toxic and corrosive nature of the chemical cargoes. It's a matter of knowing the limitation and possibility of each type or even each make of coating. Each paint manufacturer has his own resistance list stating approved cargoes, temperature and time limitations. So the manufacturer of the coating will specify what type of cargoes that are suitable for this coating and at what temperature and for how much of duration the cargo can be sustained in the tank. Many coating manufacturers give some sort of guarantee for the first 2 years after application. The coatings are categorized into two main groups. One is called the inorganic coating, containing zinc silicates and ethyl silicate types. Second is organic coatings, epoxy and modified epoxy systems. Each of them has got some good or bad characteristics. Let's see the inorganic coatings first now. Inorganic coatings are a single layer coating comprising of inorganic silicates pigmented with high percentage of zinc powder. The paint film is porous, so the cargo after the discharge of the ship can be completely removed from the coating by evaporation, but it does not happen with high density cargoes like lube oils. Generally, the life of these coatings is proportional to the thickness of the coat. Organic coatings consist of an organic resin system which, when is mixed with the hardener, it forms a cross-linked array of chemical bonds between the resin molecules. Those types of coatings have the ability to resist in more strong acids or alkalis than inorganic coatings, and they tend to absorb significant quantities of cargo, and contamination problems can still occur. So we can see that out of the two types of coating, organic coatings are more suitable for stronger and hazardous type of chemicals than inorganic coatings. Now let's come to the heart of the chemical tankers, which is the IBC code. The International Code for Construction and Equipment of Ships Carrying Dangerous Chemicals in Bulk, or in short form it's called as the IBC code. Let's see what is the purpose of this code. The purpose of this code is to provide an international standard for the safe carriage in bulk by sea, the dangerous chemicals and noxious liquid substances listed in Chapter 17 of the code. The code prescribes the design and construction standards of the ships, regardless of tonnage involved in such carriage and the equipment they shall carry, to minimize the risk of the ship, its crew and the environment, having regard to the nature of the products involved. The basic philosophy of the code is to assign to each chemical tanker one of the ship's types according to the degree of the hazards of the products carried by the such ships. Each of the products may have one or more hazardous properties including flammability, toxicity, corrosivity and reactivity, as well as the hazard they will present to the environment. So basically the code has got three functions, that is to safeguard the safety of life at sea, then safeguard the property which is the ship itself, and safeguarding the environment. So all the three are addressed by this IPC code. The code primarily deals with the ship design and equipment. In order to ensure the safe transport of the products, the total system must however be appraised. Other important facets of the safe transport of the products, such as training, operation, traffic control and handling in port, are being or will be examined for the organization. So this is an ongoing process of evaluation and modification and amendments to the code. So this can be amended as and when it comes. Of the requirements in the code, some of the most important are the ship design standards, which are measures intended to prevent accidental release of the cargo. Drafters of the BCH code, which is bulk chemical handling code, recognize that the damage to the ship resulting from the collision or grounding could lead to uncontrolled release of the cargo. Then the code describes 3 degrees of freedom or protection or to the cargo from unintended problems. So they are ships defined the location of the cargo with respect to the ship side, the bottom, and to the extent to which a ship should be capable of remaining afloat after damage. The matching of ship types to cargo takes into account the nature and the severity of the product's hazard to the environment should it be released. So, 3 types of ships, they are demarcated to carry different types of cargoes to which they have been allocated, and the ship type requirements are a fraction of many elements that comprise the code. The codes also include standards for cargo transfer, materials for construction, cargo temperature control, cargo tank vent systems, environmental control, electrical installation, fire protection and extinction, ventilation in the cargo area, instrumentation and personal protection. There are also numerous special requirements which recognize the particular hazards or problems associated with the bulk handling of specific cargoes. For example, phosphorus has 12 special requirements under IBC code because of its pyrophoric hazard, which is self-igniting. So once we know that this cargo has got this kind of hazard, so all the requirement precautions necessary for carriage and loading and discharging process are given in the IBC code. The code also includes design and equipment requirements to implement the convention controlling pollutions from the ocean of the oceans for many of the cargoes in the code, which is given under Annex 2 of the International Convention for Prevention of Pollution from Ships 1973, as modified by the Protocol of 1978, commonly called as the MARPOL 1973-78. With the inclusion of Annex 2 marine pollution considerations, the codes have evolved into a comprehensive set of standards for the safe shipment of bulk hazardous cargoes by sea. The codes regulate a very specific set of cargoes. The cargoes are, there are 3 types of products. The first type is products having significant hazards, fire hazards in excess of those of petroleum products and similar flammable products. Petroleum products come under the category of oil cargoes. So if this cargo is having more flammability issues more than them, they come under this category. Then B, products having significant hazards in addition to or other than flammability. Then C is the products which may present a hazard to the environment if accidentally released. So all these 3 are the specific codes which are being addressed in this IBC code. The complex process known as hazard evaluation is used to determine if a cargo falls within the scope of this code, and if it does, then a set of minimum requirements are developed for the cargo and it is added to the codes. The codes also list products that have been determined to fall outside the scope of the codes. So all the products which are coming under the scope of this codes, there is a hazard evaluation. So all this is brought across and then identified to the carrier and the ship which they have to ultimately carry the cargo. Now let's see why or to whom or what type of ships is IBC code applicable to. The code applies to ships regardless of the size. Most of the codes in the marine are applicable to ships more than 500 gross tonnage. However, we see here that the IBC code is applicable to all ships regardless of size, including those less than 500 gross tonnage, engaged in the carriage of bulk cargoes of dangerous chemical or noxious liquid substances other than petroleum or similar flammable products, as follows. Number 1, product is product having significant fire hazards in excess of those of petroleum products and similar products. Non-control products have significant hazards in other than nuclear mobility. This we have seen in the previous slide as well. Liquids covered by the code are those having a vapor pressure not exceeding 0.2 MPa absolute at temperature of 37.8 degrees. So this specifies at what temperature, what is the pressure, vapor pressure that are included in the code. For the purpose of 1974 SOLAS Convention, the code applies to ships which are engaged in the carriage of products, including in the chapter 17 on the basis of their safety characteristics and identified as safety or pollution hazard. For the purposes of MARPOL 1973-78, the code applies only to noxious liquid substances tankers which are engaged in the carriage of NLS identified by the categories of X, Y and Z. These are the three types of chemicals that are identified under Annex 2 of MARPOL, noxious liquid substances. Unless expressly provided otherwise, the code applies to ships, the keels of which are laid or which are at a stage where the construction identifiable with the ship begins and assembly has commenced, comprising of at least 50 tons or 1% of the estimated mass of all structural material, whichever is less, on or after 1st July 1986. Welcome to this video lecture series on chemical tanker notes for nautical science students. Let's start off with the notes. First, we'll see what are the types of tank coatings that are available on chemical tankers and why is the need for tank coating. So, a modern chemical tanker shall have all the cargo tanks coated unless they are made of stainless steel. Stainless steel, as we know, that it's very inert product and will not react with most of the other chemicals. So the main reasons for coating are easier cleaning and less risk of cargo contamination. The durability of properly applied and maintained coatings may be 10 years or more. On the other hand, one mistake in the cargo selection may totally ruin a coating. So if you load a cargo which is not suitable to that coating, then the coating will get spoiled instantaneously because of the toxic and corrosive nature of the chemical cargoes. It's a matter of knowing the limitation and possibility of each type or even each make of coating. Each paint manufacturer has his own resistance list stating approved cargoes, temperature and time limitations. So the manufacturer of the coating will specify what type of cargoes that are suitable for this coating and at what temperature and for how much of duration the cargo can be sustained in the tank. Many coating manufacturers give some sort of guarantee for the first 2 years after application. The coatings are categorized into two main groups. One is called as inorganic coating, containing zinc silicates and ethyl silicate types. Second is organic coatings, epoxy and modified epoxy systems. Each of them has got its own good or bad characteristics. Let's see the inorganic coatings first now. Inorganic coatings are a single layer coating comprising of inorganic silicates pigmented with high percentage of zinc powder. The paint film is porous, so the cargo after the discharge of the ship can be completely removed from the coating by evaporation, but it does not happen with high density cargoes like lube oils. Generally, the life of these coatings is proportional to the thickness of the coat. Organic coatings consist of an organic resin system which, when is mixed with the hardener, it forms a cross-linked array of chemical bonds between the resin molecules. Those types of coatings have the ability to resist in more strong acids or alkalis than inorganic coatings, and they tend to absorb significant quantities of cargo, and contamination problems can still occur. So we can see that out of the two types of coating, organic coatings are more suitable for stronger and hazardous type of chemicals than inorganic coatings. Now let's come to the heart of the chemical tankers, which is the IBC code. The International Code for Construction and Equipment of Ships Carrying Dangerous Chemicals in Bulk, or in short form it's called as the IBC code. Let's see what is the purpose of this code. The purpose of this code is to provide an international standard for the safe carriage in bulk by sea, the dangerous chemicals and noxious liquid substances listed in Chapter 17 of the Code. The Code prescribes the design and construction standards of the ships, regardless of tonnage involved in such carriage and the equipment they shall carry, to minimize the risk of the ship, its crew and the environment, having regard to the nature of the products involved. The basic philosophy of the Code is to assign to each chemical tanker one of the ship's types according to the degree of the hazards of the products carried by the such ships. Each of the products may have one or more hazardous properties, including flammability, toxicity, corrosivity and reactivity, as well as the hazard they will present to the environment. So basically the Code has got three functions, that is to safeguard the safety of life at sea, then safeguard the property which is the ship itself, and safeguarding the environment. So all the three are addressed by this IPC Code. The Code primarily deals with the ship design and equipment in order to ensure the safe transport of the products. The total system must, however, be appraised. Other important facets of the safe transport of the products, such as training, operation, traffic control and handling in port, are being or will be examined further by the organization. So this is an ongoing process of evaluation and modification and amendments to the Code. So this can be amended as and when it comes. Of the requirements in the Code, some of the most important are the ship design standards, which are measures intended to prevent accidental release of the cargo. Drafters of the BCH Code, which is Bulk Chemical Handling Code, recognize that the damage to the ship resulting from the collision or grounding could lead to uncontrolled release of the cargo. Then the Code describes three degrees of freedom or protection or to the cargo from unintended problems. So they are ships defined the location of the cargo with respect to the ship side, the bottom, and to the extent to which a ship should be capable of remaining afloat after damage. The matching of ship types to cargo takes into account the nature and the severity of the product's hazard to the environment should it be released. So three types of ships, they are demarcated to carry different types of cargoes to which they have been allocated, and the ship type requirements are a fraction of many elements that comprise the Code. The Codes also include standards for cargo transfer, materials for construction, cargo temperature control, cargo tank vent systems, environmental control, electrical installation, fire protection and extinction, ventilation in the cargo area, instrumentation and personal protection. There are also numerous special requirements which recognize the particle hazards or problems associated with the bulk handling of specific cargoes. For example, phosphorus has 12 special requirements under IBC Code because of its pyrophoric hazard, which is self-igniting. So once we know that this cargo has got this kind of hazard, so all the requirement precautions necessary for carriage and loading and discharging process are given in the IBC Code. The Code also includes design and equipment requirements to implement the Convention controlling pollutions from the ocean of the oceans for many of the cargoes in the Code, which is given under Annex 2 of the International Convention for Prevention of Pollution from Ships 1973, as modified by the Protocol of 1978, commonly called as the MARPOL 1973-78. With the inclusion of Annex 2 marine pollution considerations, the Codes have evolved into a comprehensive set of standards for the safe shipment of bulk hazardous cargoes by sea. The Codes regulate a very specific set of cargoes. The cargoes are, there are three types of products. The first type is products having significant hazards, fire hazards in excess of those of petroleum products and similar flammable products. Petroleum products come under the category of oil cargoes. So if this cargo is having more flammability issues more than them, they come under this category. Then B, products having significant hazards in addition to or other than flammability. And C is the products which may present a hazard to the environment if accidentally released. So all these three are the specific codes which are being addressed in this IBC code. The complex process known as hazard evaluation is used to determine if a cargo falls within the scope of this code. And if it does, then a set of minimum requirements are developed for the cargo and it is added to the codes. The codes also list products that have been determined to fall outside the scope of the codes. So all the products which are coming under the scope of this codes, there is a hazard evaluation. So all this is brought across and then identified to the carrier and the ship which they have to ultimately carry the cargo. Now let's see why or to whom or what type of ships is IBC code applicable to. The code applies to ships regardless of the size. Most of the codes in the marine are applicable to ships more than 500 gross tonnage. However, we see here that the IBC code is applicable to all ships regardless of size, including those less than 500 gross tonnage, engaged in the carriage of bulk cargoes of dangerous chemical or noxious liquid substances other than petroleum or similar flammable products as follows. Number one, product. These products having significant fire hazards in excess of those of petroleum products and similar products. Number two, products having significant hazards in other than flammability. This we have seen in the previous slide as well. Liquids covered by the code are those having a vapor pressure not exceeding 0.2 MPa absolute at temperature of 37.8 degrees. So this specifies at what temperature, what is the pressure, vapor pressure that are included in the code. For the purpose of 1974 Solas Convention, the code applies to ships which are engaged in the carriage of products, including in the chapter 17 on the basis of their safety characteristics and identified as safety or pollution hazard. For the purposes of MARPOL 1973-78, the code applies only to noxious liquid substances tankers which are engaged in the carriage of NLS, identified by the categories of X, Y and Z. These are the three types of chemicals that are identified under Annex 2 of MARPOL, noxious liquid substances. Unless expressly provided otherwise, the code applies to ships, the keels of which are laid or which are at a stage where the construction identifiable with the ship begins and assembly has commenced, comprising of at least 50 tons or 1% of the estimated mass of all structural material, whichever is less, on or after 1st July 1986. P&A manual, that's a very important manual which is carried out on board the tankers. And from 1st January 2007, every ship certified to carry substances of category X, Y or Z shall have on board an approved updated P&A manual, and it should be in the language English, French or Spanish. The text shall have a translation in one of these languages. So these are the three languages which have been identified. The main purpose of the manual is to identify for the ship's officers the physical arrangements and all the operational procedures with respect to the cargo handling, tank cleaning, slop handling and cargo tank ballasting and deballasting. Manuals are approved on a ship by ship basis. So this is a very important manual. All seafarers who are joining that ship must go through this manual so as to understand the procedures and arrangements which have been provided to facilitate all these critical operations on board tankers, which include loading, discharging, ballasting, deballasting, venting, gas freeing and etc. all the other operations. Now let's come to some of this terminology regarding the vapors and the health aspect. Threshold limit value of a product. The threshold limit value of a product are exposure standards recommended by a committee of the American Conference of Governmental Industrial Hygienists. In short, it's called as ACGIH. And what does TLV, as it is called, represent? It represents the maximum average airborne concentration of a hazardous material to which healthy adult worker can be exposed during an 8-hour workday and a 40-hour week over a working lifetime without experiencing significant health hazards. So this is the definition of TLB. TLB has been subdivided into three components. That is called as a time weighted average, or in short form it is called as TWA. The concentration of a contaminant averaged over a workday, usually for a period of 8 hours long, is measured in a workplace by sampling a worker's breathing zone for the whole workday. ACGIH recommends that the TWA should not exceed up to an 8-hour working day during a 40-hour week. Now let's come to the second component of TLB, that is called as a ceiling value. A concentration of a toxic substance in air that ACGIH recommends should not be exceeded at any time during the workday. This value is often used in conjunction with TWA. Then the third one is short-term exposure limit, STEL value. A TWA concentration over 15 minutes that ACGIH recommends not to exceed, even if the 8-hour TWA is within the standards. TWA, STEL are given for contaminants which short-term hazards are known. So these three components are vital to understand to avoid unnecessary exposure, so that our health of the seafarers working exposed to these gases are safeguarded. Now let's come to the odor threshold. What is an odor threshold? Odor, as we know, is the ability of the nose to detect smell. The smell, we can find out pleasant smell, pungent smell. So odor threshold value, OTV, as it is popularly called as, also called as aroma threshold value, ATV, is defined as the most minimal concentration of a substance that can be detected by a human nose. Some substances can be detected when the concentration is only few milligrams per thousand tons, which is less than a drop in an Olympic swimming pool. Odor threshold value can be expressed as a concentration in water or concentration in air. Two major types of flavor thresholds can be distinguished, the absolute and the different threshold. The odor detection threshold and the odor recognition threshold, or absolute threshold. The first is the minimum concentration at which an odor can be detected without any requirements to identify or recognize the stimulus, while the second is the minimum concentration at which a stimulus can be identified or recognized. The odor threshold value of an odorant is influenced by the medium. So if you have a medium which is already having lot of odors, so the specific odor may be masked. So, and it's an odorless place or a neutral compartment, you can be able to identify the smell of an odorant. Now we are coming to the cargo data sheets. What are cargo data sheets? These are documents which identify the details of the products which are loaded onto the ship, and these are provided by the shipper and to the master so that necessary action can be taken further. So what are the contents of cargo data sheet? They contain product identifier and the chemical identity of the product, manufacturer or importer details, emergency telephone number. If in case of any emergency happening on the ship, they can contact this hotline and find out the details regarding that. Then date of preparation or last review, then hazard identification, hazard statement and precautionary statements, composition of the substance and information on hazardous ingredients, first aid measures, firefighting measures and accidental release measures. Exposure control, including exposure standards, engineering controls and personal protection information. Information relating to handling and storage, including how the substance may be safely used. Disposal considerations, information relating to the physical and chemical properties of the substance. Information relating to the physical and chemical properties of the substance, stability and reactivity information, toxicological information including health effects. So these are the contents of the cargo data sheet. Now we are coming to vapor return line, which is a specific entity which is introduced for in the chemical trade, especially when you are loading toxic gases. So it is loaded in a closed circuit environment. The vapors are not vented out because of the toxic, so as to prevent any health issues to the crew members. So chemical tankers operate under a closed loading program. The aim of the closed loading program is to keep gases clear of the cargo deck. The cargo is not visible to the crew at the stage of loading. The use of vapor return line prevents gas release to the atmosphere. So this is a diagram showing discharging with the gas return line, the tank, the vapor header, the spray header, the liquid header, inert gas, boiler, and all is shown in this diagram. Now we will come to the ship shore safety checklist, which is a very important phenomenon before we start any cargo operations. This has to be signed by the representative of the terminal and also by the representative of the ship for in charge for cargo loading, which is normally the chief officer. So what does it contain? It contains the ship's name, the berth, the port, the date of arrival, the time of arrival, instructions for completion. The safety of operation requires that all questions should be answered affirmatively by ticking the appropriate box. If an affirmative answer is not possible, the reason should be given and agreement reached upon appropriate precautions to be taken between the ship and the terminal. Where any question is considered to be not applicable, then a note to that effect should be inserted in the remarks column. A box in the column ship and terminal indicates that the check should be carried out by a party concerned. The presence of the letters APR in the column code indicates the following. A means any procedures or agreements should be in writing with the remarks column of this checklist or other mutually acceptable form. In either case, the signature of both parties should be required. B, in the case of negative answer, the operation should not be carried out without the permission of the port authority. R indicates the items to be rechecked at intervals not exceeding that agreed in the declaration. Now let's see the contents of the checklist. Part A, bulk liquid general. The first point is the ship securely moved or not. Moving is very vital, otherwise the weight will come on the cargo hoses or the chicksons and they may break, and when they break, cargo can be released accidentally and that can cause harm to the crew or to the environment or the ship itself. And then we have to have remarks, stop cargo at how many winds, velocity, and disconnect the at what winds, and unberthing the ship from if the winds are becoming very high. The second point are emergency towing wires correctly positioned. Emergency towing wires should be correctly positioned at the forward and stern so that in case of emergency, the tugs can pull the ship out immediately after an emergency shutdown of cargo operation. Number three is safe access between ship and shore. So the workers who are coming to the ship and the crew members going ashore must be safely be able to cross the boundary between the ship and the shore. Number four is the ship ready to move under its own power. Is the machinery available and the ship is ready to sail out without any undue delay in case of any emergency. Number five, effective watchkeeping on board, adequate supervision in terminal of the ship, agreed ship shore communication system operative, as the emergency signal to be used on the ship explained and understood. In case of an emergency, what are the emergency signals which can be utilized by the ship and the shore to identify an emergency? Hazards associated with toxic substances in cargo being handled, being identified and understood. Emergency shutdown procedure has it been agreed. Fire hoses, firefighting equipment on board are positioned ready for immediate use. Cargo and bunker hoses, arms in good condition, properly rigged and appropriate for the service intended. Are scuppers effective plug and rip trays in position both on board and ashore? Are unused cargo and bunker connection properly secured with blank flanges fully bolted? Are sea and overboard discharge valves, when not in use, closed and visibly secured? Are all cargo and bunker tank lids closed? Is the agreed tank venting system being used? Have the PA vents been operated using the checklist facility and the operation of the vents verified? Are the hand torches of approved type? There are supposed to be intrinsically safe torches. Now the point number 20, we are coming to portable VHF or UHF trans receivers are of approved type. They should also be of approved nature so that they should not cause any static electricity problems. Are the ship's main radio transmitter aerials earthed and radar switched off? Are electrical cables to portable electrical equipment disconnected from power? Are all external doors and ports in the accommodation closed? Are window type air conditioning units disconnected? Are the main air conditioning air intakes which may permit the entry of the cargo vapors closed? Are the requirements for use of galley equipment and cooking appliances being observed? Smoking regulations be observed. No smoking absolutely on this type of ships because smoking is a very big fire hazard. Naked light regulations, no naked light permitted on deck and even anywhere on the ships. Is there a provision for an emergency escape? Are sufficient personnel on board and assured to deal with an emergency? Even though shore leave is granted, we must ensure that half the crew members at least should be available to deal with the emergency. Then adequate insulating means in place in the ship shore connection. Have measures been taken to ensure sufficient pump room ventilation? If the ship is capable of closed loading, have requirements for closed off loading operations been agreed? Has a vapor return line been connected? If a vapor return line is connected, have operating parameters been agreed? Are ship's emergency fire control plans located externally? Then for IG system, there are some checklists. There are about 7 more points which needs to be checked. Is the inert gas system fully operational and in good working order? Are the deck seals in good working order? Deck seals prevent the leakages of inert gas and toxic gas accumulation. Liquid levels in the PV breakers, correct. PV breakers are very important equipment which regulates the pressure inside the tank. Have the fixed and portable oxygen analyzers been calibrated and are they working properly? So these analyzers, they give us an indication of the percentage of toxic and explosive gases and oxygen content in the tank. Are fixed IG pressure and oxygen recorders working? Are all cargo tank atmospheres at positive pressure with an oxygen content of 8% by volume? Generally, an atmosphere in the tank is considered as inert if the oxygen content is less than 8%. Are all the individual tank IG valves fitted, correctly set and locked? Are all the persons in charge of cargo operations aware that in the case of failure in the inert gas plant, discharge operations should cease and the terminal be advised? If the ship is planning to do tank cleaning alongside, the following questions should be answered. Some of the type of chemicals like category X, there is a mandatory pre-wash. For that, the surveyor will be checking what is the content of the cargo in the effluent, and it has to be less than 0.01% by weight. Then only the ship will be able to sail out and load further cargo. Because this type of cargo, category X, is very stringent and is not permitted to be tank cleaned and discharged into the sea. So there are some tank cleaning operations planned during the stay. During the ship's stay alongside installation, yes or no? If so, the port authority has been informed or not. So these are the 45-46 points which have to be agreed between the ship and the terminal before the cargo operations start on board a chemical tanker. This is very vital, and this has to be done judiciously without any mistake to avoid any accidents and incidents on board tankers. Cargo record book. This is mandatory as per the law that you need to maintain a cargo record book, and every ship to which the annex applies, this is annex 2 of Mark 1, shall be provided with a cargo record book, whether as part of the ship's official logbook or otherwise in the specified form. The cargo record book shall be completed on a tank-to-tank basis whenever any of the following operations with respect to a noxious liquid substance takes place in the ship. And what are the operations that are needed to be recorded in the cargo record book? Loading of cargo, internal transfer of cargo, unloading of cargo, mandatory pre-wash, cleaning of cargo tanks, discharge into the sea of tank washings, ballasting of cargo tanks, discharge of ballast from cargo tanks, accidental or other exceptional discharge controlled by authorized surveyors. Each entry shall be signed by the officer or officers in charge of the operation concerned, and each page shall be signed by the master. The cargo record book shall be kept in such a place as to be readily available for inspection, and except in the case of unmanned ships, under tow shall be kept on board the ship. It shall be retained for a period of 3 years after the last entry has been made. The competent authority of the government of a party may inspect the cargo record book on board any ship to which this annex applies while the ship is in its port. Now, there are four types of tanks pertaining to chemical tankers. One is called an independent tank. Independent tank means a cargo containment envelope which is not contiguous with or part of the hull structure. An independent tank is built and installed so as to eliminate, whenever possible, its stressing as a result of stressing the motion of the adjacent hull structure. An independent tank is not essential to the structural completeness of the ship's hull. Independent cargo compartment is cargo tanks that do not transfer the pressure loads to the hull when they are loaded. Therefore, only the tank weight is transferred to the cradles or the support points of the hull. The cargo tanks are built with support to prevent the tank from slipping forward, astern, to the slide or floating up. Integral tank. Integral tank means a cargo containment envelope which forms the part of the ship hull and which may be stressed in the same manner and by the same loads which stress the contiguous hull structure, which is normally essential to the structural completeness of the ship's hull. The cargo tank is an integral part of the hull, so the hull absorbs the weight and the pressure from the cargo. Gravity tank. Gravity tank means a tank having a design pressure not greater than 0.7 bar gauge at the top of the tank. The gravity tank may be independent or integral. A gravity tank should be constructed and tested according to the standards of the administration, taking into account the temperature of the cargo and relative density of the cargo. The last type of tank is a pressure tank. Pressure tank means a tank having a design pressure greater than 0.7 bar. A pressure tank should be an independent tank and should be a configuration permitting application of pressure vessel design criteria according to the standards of the administration or the flag state of the ship. Now this we will quickly go through the cargo piping system. The cargo piping system ensures that different types of non-compatible cargoes which are loaded as parcels in chemical tanker are not coming into contact. There are two types of cargo piping system. One is called as a group main system, the second is an independent piping system. This is the diagram of a group main system used in conventional oil tankers as well as in chemical tankers when they are intending to load few non-reactive cargoes. And let's come to the independent system or one tank, one pump system. This is more complicated, and in this type of thing, in this type of arrangement, you can load almost 300 types of cargoes in tanker. And there are different pumps, different tanks, different lines, the valves are separate. So segregation is maintained very stringently. One cargo does not come in contact with the other cargo. This is one tank, one pump system. Then these six methods of tank cleaning are mentioned here. Buttermouthing, injection tank cleaning, recirculation tank cleaning, recirculation by cleaning using service tank, rinsing, mop, vent, mop and dry. Then the hazards during tank cleaning: fire and explosion, saponification, polymerization, corrosion, overexposure can cause toxicity, and acidification, oxygen deficiency, emission to the air can cause problem health issues, and to the water can cause death to flora and fauna in the environment, in the sea. Slop tanks where the tank cleaning residues are collected for after cleaning of the tanks for category XYZ. Then tank washing cycles. Tank washing cycles means that 360 degree rotation of a tank machine is called as a tank washing cycle. And for category X, which is a very stringent cargo, for non-solidifying substances, we do one complete cycle, and for solidifying substances, two cycles are carried. And for category Y, half a cycle, and for solidifying substances, one cycle is carried out. So we'll be continuing on this topic in the subsequent series of notes for chemical tanker and gas tanker in my second lecture series. I thank you for seeing this video. Thank you very much.